Okay, muito boa tarde a todos. Estamos aqui para mais uma sessão das conferências do CIDEF dedicada aos desafios da presidência portuguesa. Nós vamos hoje discutir a Europa social e os desafios que se colocam à presidência portuguesa, e vamos ter a sessão repartida em dois painéis. O primeiro painel vai decorrer em inglês, uma vez que estes temas não são apenas do interesse nacional, são obviamente também do interesse de um público mais amplo. E neste primeiro painel vamos então ter estas primeiras intervenções em inglês. No, na segunda parte, com o Dr. Manuel Carvalho da Silva e a professora Cláudia Monge, vamos ter um debate em português, ok? Portanto, farão as apresentações em português e o debate terá lugar em português. Por isso, eu vou agora dirigir algumas palavras em inglês e fazer uma breve apresentação do tema, e vamos então iniciar os nossos trabalhos. Ora bem. Now, shifting to English, I welcome everyone who's attending. This first panel will take place in English. All the presentations will be made in English, and there will also be time for some Q&A at the end of this part of the debate. Following some of the presentations, I will present a couple of questions regarding each presentation. You will be able to go to this website called www.menti.com, and you'll be able to vote on these questions. And your input is important because then at the end of the first panel, once the presentations are finished, then we will have the results of these of your answers to these questions, and we will be able to use them to fuel our debate. So this allows you to take an active part in the in this conference. So a few introductory words. Now, the social challenges of economic integration in Europe are part of the DNA of the European Union. And despite the predominance of product and service market reforms, mainly to be achieved in the context of deregulation and the privatization movement that dominated the 1980s and 1990s, together with a strongly monetarist emphasis with regard to economic and monetary union, the political consensus underlying the creation of the European Union in 1993 by the Maastricht Treaty also contemplated a social dimension. Social policy was then viewed, following the leadership of President Jacques Delors, as a necessary counterweight to free competition and open markets. This progress was achieved despite the resistance put up by those who feared that increased social protection would impair the competitiveness of domestic industries, as exemplified by the UK's opt-out or the 11 opt-in on the social chapter of the Maastricht Treaty. The United Kingdom then joined the social chapter in 1998 with the Amsterdam Treaty. The idea of a need to shield the so-called European social market. The European social model was then a pivotal, but nonetheless controversial principle of European integration. Now, the economic and social transformations of the early decades of the 21st century placed social policies in the background, while political and economic priorities focused on the financial crisis of 2008 and the subsequent Eurozone crisis. In the member states most afflicted by the crisis, deprived of the monetary and foreign exchange tools traditionally available to other countries, fiscal adjustment took place at the cost of social rights, all this amid social unrest. In the meantime, digitalization created new challenges with the gig economy and the so-called uberization of several service industries being hailed by some as a deregulatory achievement that promoted growth, or decried by others as a race to the bottom that harmed jobs and ultimately consumers, as price competition arguably comes at the expense of quality and safety standards that apply to more traditional business models. The refugee crisis that followed the Arab Spring, and in particular the war in Syria, added to an inflow of migrants from Africa, the Middle East, and Asia. And this proved to be a very difficult stress test to European solidarity. The rift caused by the debate between member states arguing for a truly European approach to these challenges and those that found it politically convenient to shut down borders has left its marks in ongoing tensions within the EU. In sum, the outlook for a more egalitarian Europe with strong protection of social rights and offering opportunities to integrate migrants and to provide asylum seekers with a sort of land of opportunity was quite dim by the end of 2019. And then came the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, massive state intervention became inevitable. And remarkably, the European Commission's early response to the crisis adopted as one of its first steps the suspension, or at least the declawing, of the budgetary constraints on Eurozone countries, thus anticipating a government-led support to businesses and workers hit by the crisis that followed widespread lockdowns. Suddenly, forms of social support that were viewed as marginal ideas have come to the center of the public debate. And the scale of the crisis led to an even more surprising willingness to have a strong response at EU level. So it seems that the lessons of the Eurozone crisis have finally come to fruition. So far, still stuck by the debate on the conditionality on the basis of what is supposed to be a core principle of EU integration, the rule of law, a EU stimulus response seems inevitable. However, the COVID-19 crisis will continue to have an impact in terms of rising inequalities. How can the EU meet these challenges and what can be expected of the Portuguese presidency in the coming months are the general topics proposed to our speakers. I thank them for accepting to take part in this conference and look forward to hear their expert perspectives on these issues. Now, in the first part of our panel, we will have the contributions by Professor Renato Miguel do Carmo, professor at ISCTE, and also one of the scientific coordinators of Colabor, which is a research project that is being conducted in association with the CDEF. It will be followed by an intervention by Sofia Duha. She's a PhD candidate at the University of Amsterdam, and she will talk about social policy. Professor Benedita Queiroz from the University Catholic University of Portugal, School of Oporto, will speak on some issues regarding migration policy and asylum policy. And that topic will also be addressed by Professor Anarita Gil, formerly of Nova University and now a colleague here at the University of Lisbon Law School. We will then have Professor Manuel Carvalho da Silva. He is the chair of and coordinator of Colabor, the line of research I mentioned earlier, an investigator, a researcher at SES, the Center for Economic Studies and Social Studies. And he's a well-known public figure in Portugal, both in politics and in academia. And we will finally have Professor Claudia Monge, another colleague from the University of Lisbon Law School. So without further ado, let me pass the floor, the virtual floor, to Professor Renato Miguel Carmo. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. So first of all, I would like to thank Professor Eduardo Paz Ferreira and also Professor Miguel Moura Silva for this invitation. It's for me a great honor to be here. I will share my PowerPoint. I basically will present, my presentation will be about inequalities. So I will present an overview of the structural trends on inequality. And sorry for this. With a focus, of course, in Europe, but also with the I will also present a comparison view regarding other parts of the world, namely the United States of America. So there are, in the last years, several important projects about inequalities. I would like to highlight this one. It's a World Inequality Database. This is basically it's a portal with many information regarding income and wealth inequality. It's conducted by well-known economists like Piketty and others. And regarding Piketty, I will basically present here the main trends regarding income and health inequality in first place. So, of course, this graphic that I am presenting now. It's about the distribution of income by the 10% decile of share income. But of course, what I would like to highlight here is, first of all, is that in the beginning of the center, Europe was a very unequal continent, and we had a higher level of inequality comparing, for instance, with the United States. And of course, during this last century, many things happened here, two wars, a Great Depression, and so on and so on. And of course, in these last three decades, we have this neoliberal agenda that came off with the globalization and so on. But what is interesting here is why, like it in the end of the century or in the beginning of 2000, inequalities began to rise again, but the level of inequality in the United States is higher than in Europe. So the same happening with wealth. When we look at wealth, we are looking at ownership, property, basically. The levels of inequality were tremendously high in the beginning of the end of the 18th century. For instance, we are looking at the 10th wealth share on Europe and United States. Look at the numbers in the beginning of in the end of the 19th century, and the same thing. So Europe were more unequal, and inequalities decreased along the 20th century, and they are now, since three decades ago, rising again, and United States are in a very most unequal situation than Europe. Regarding the several parts of the world, the several regions of the world, you can see here that for Europe, so now we are looking at the top 10% national income share, and in fact, Europe is, in terms of these great big regions, is the less unequal region of the world. Of course, you have inequalities. I'm going to talk about this, of course, but comparing with other parts of the world, United States, the BRICS, and Middle West, and so on. So there, the levels of inequality are very, very strong. And when you look at the trends, it's very impressive, some of the trends. For instance, when you look at Russia, it's very impressive how, for instance, in 2060, 65% of the national income was received by the top 10 earners in India, against 21% nowadays. And in Russia, it's tremendous, this rise of inequality that happens in the 19th. Looking at Europe, inequalities are rising during this period, but when you compare with other parts of the world, in fact, we don't have the same rise of inequality that appears in other regions. At the same time, we have regions, parts of the world, where inequalities stay very high, like Brazil, like the Middle East, and so on. This is a very interesting graphics, and it's important to reflect these trends of inequality. And the way this, the concentration of income, of wealth, in fact, was very stronger, and still is very strong and very deep in the United States of America. When you look at this graphic, it's very impressive what's happened in the United States during the last three, four decades. In fact, when you compare the 1% with the bottom 50%, it's very impressive. And we are looking now, so this comparison between the 1% and the bottom 50%, so it's very impressive what happened during the 80s and the 90s. So in the beginning of the 80s, the top 1% only received 11% of the income. In the end, in 2016, so the 1%, they received more than 20% of the national income. So this is a tremendous rise of inequalities and concentration of income. Looking at the bottom 50%, we notice the other side of this trend. So in the 80s, the bottom 50%, they received 20% of the national income, and in 2016, less than 50%. When you compare with Europe, we have a different trend. Of course, this rising of inequalities concerning the 1% is happening. And at the same time, the bottom 50% are narrowing the level of income that they received. But of course, we don't. The situation is different regarding what's happened with United States. So this doesn't mean that Europe is. That inequality is not a problem in Europe. Of course it is. And of course we are looking here, comparing two great regions, Europe and United States. But when we look at Europe, and for instance, we have this paper that was published recently about inequalities and redistribution in Europe, from this World Inequality Database. And when you look at it's been happening in Europe, in fact, this is a graphic that look at the distribution of European growth in terms of income between 1918 and 2017. So, and in fact, we looked at, during this period, the bottom 50% only captured 15% of the income growth. And the top 1% captured during this period 70% of the growth of income growth. So this means that we have here profound process, profound trends that are producing inequalities. Of course, the situation in Europe, in average, it's better comparing with other parts of the world, mainly United States. But at the same time, we notice worrying trends regarding the concentration of income on the top. And when we look at this graphic that basically makes a comparison regarding different regions in Europe, it's very interesting that in the beginning of the 80s, the Southern European countries were the most unequal in Europe, and the Eastern European countries were the less unequal in Europe, on average, of course. And when you look at the trends during these last three, four decades, it's very impressive what has been happening in the European Eastern countries, where the inequalities start growing, rising tremendously during the 90s and the 2000s. And there now are the most, one of there, we find there the most unequal countries in the Europe. The situation of the European, Southern Europe countries, European countries are more or less the same. So this means that inequality is still high in these countries. But at the same time, when you look at the northern countries, you look that the inequality has been rising as well.
The inequality has been rising during this period in all parts of Europe. And you should be concerned with this. So, of course, there are many drivers regarding this situation. There are economic and social drivers. One of these is labor market, and this is this relation between different sources of income regarding, for instance, capital and labor. When we look at the difference between capital and labor, we notice this is an important report made by the International Labor Organization about Portugal. It was published in 2018. And this graphic is very impressive regarding this relation between capital and labor. We are looking here about the percentage of the of labor income in the GDP. And what is happening is that the income, the labor income, labor is basically lose importance regarding other forms of income, mainly capital. And what's happening in Portugal is very impressive as well. So, and this is general trends, but this means that the income coming from labor, it's losing its value, is losing its position, and we should, of course, discuss this as well. Of course, there are several relations between inequality and mobility. This is a very important report that was published by OECD 2 years ago, and we found there very important trends. For instance, this relation between inequality and mobility is one of the most structural problems that we have nowadays in the contemporary societies. Basically, this elevator, social elevator, was broken, stagnated. And we found this in several countries. Portugal is one of them, but in the United States and so on. And this is a way of showing the problem. Regarding intergenerational mobility, this idea that in average it takes 4 or 5 generations for the offspring of the low income family to reach the average income. So we are talking about the bottom 10%, which is tremendous. Of course, some countries in Europe are better, like the northern ones. Portugal, in fact, the average is 5 generations, which is tremendous. And we are at the same level of United States or UK and so on. And we have other countries from basically outside Europe that the average is 8 generations or even 10 generations. So mobility is a tremendous problem, and the relation between mobility, social mobility, and inequality is in fact very accurate. And this represents that we have here a tremendous challenge in terms of public policies. I also present this slide, which is very impressive as well. That is the percentage of manager and manual workers if parents are manual workers. So parents are manual workers, regarding, for instance, Portugal, only 10% of these people reach to a position of manager. And as you can see, and on the other side, more than 50% maintain this position as manual worker. And when you compare with other countries, we see that the situation in Portugal, the gap in Portugal is the higher regarding the other countries. This means that we have a problem here, not only on inequality, not only on mobility, but also social reproduction. This is very strong, and this is a structural trend, and it's very difficult to invert this trend. Of course, one way to invert is through education. So education mobility, educational mobility is in fact a way to reduce this gap. In fact, we still have a problem in Portugal regarding educational mobility. It seems that here we find also social reproduction. And this is a thing that we should also look at. So of course, many things, good things were taken part in Portugal through education. So our educational system grow, massification, democratization, so on. But we are still in the bottom of Europe regarding this situation. Another issue that I would like to highlight is the problem of public of voice in public sphere of citizenship. This is also very concerning data that I'm presenting here. And what we are notice here is that in fact, and this voice, and I compare with different economic situations. So these people are in the improved situation, economic situation, if there is the economic situation got worse or is more or less the same. Here as well, Portugal is very badly positioned. And as you can see in this graphic, only Latvia is the country that are worse than ours. And in fact, we have here a problem of people that they don't feel that their voice is represented in the public sphere. And there is not much difference regarding their economic situation. So this is very, very concerning. And in fact, we have a lot of problems regarding our public sphere and the way people participate through civic actions and activism and so on. In the end of the day, this is also a problem on democracy. I'm going to present the last, I don't know how many minutes I have for, if I have to finish, but.
5 minutes, okay.
How much? Five?
Okay, maximum.
5 minutes, okay, so that's enough. So this is basically this author's Richard Wilkinson and Kate Pickett, they published a book in 2009 named The Spirit Level, and then this is the latest book about this, they call it The Inner Level, and they look not only on economical backgrounds about regarding inequality, but also on existential issues. And one of the graphics they present is this one, and I think this is very expressive, regarding what I was talking about, that this idea that there is a relation between civic participation, the levels of civil participation, and income inequality. And in this graphic, Portugal is one of the countries that is in the worst position. And in fact, we are one of the most unequal countries in Europe. You already know that. But at the same time, we have very low levels of civic participation. Only a few Eastern European countries have this position that we have. It's at the same time is very concerning that basically the countries that are more unequal are the ones where people participate less, which means that we have here a problem also on democracy in these countries. And this could be very worrying regarding the future, in regarding this pandemic crisis, because this pandemic crisis is a crisis, it's an economic crisis, of course. It's a wealth crisis in terms of, but is at the same time a crisis on democracy, and people now have a lot of, a lot of constraints regarding civic participation. So this crisis is basically dipping the iato, the gap that I present in the last slide, which means that the people that are suffering more are the ones that are that have more difficulty to live, of course, to have a way of life, standards of life, minimum standards of life, but at the same time are the ones that have more difficulties to have a voice in the public sphere, to have a voice that represents their insatisfactions and their claims and so on and so on. And in this context where the populist movements are rising, we should be concerned with these trends, with this situation regarding Portugal, and not only Portugal, but in our case, we have to be very concerned about this. We have, in fact, nowadays, the main ingredients that could lead to the increasing of populist movements. So just to finish, we have only to basically to present this reference, the International Labour Organization, they published a year ago this report about work for a brighter future with a lot of proposals regarding precisely the increasing of the position of labor in the economy, and also at the same time to invest in a lot of policies regarding the social protection of the labor force. So they have some proposals here. I would like to highlight some of them. For instance, this idea to guarantee a universal coverage of social protection from birth to old age. This universal labor guarantee that provides a labor protection floor for all workers. And this idea, I will finish with this, this idea to expand time sovereignty. In the last in the last years, I'm also been working this idea of time, social time, born. And I've been interview people that are in a very vulnerable situation, like unemployed people or people, precarious workers, and so on and so on. When one thing that came out with very, which is very deep, is this idea that people lose their control of time. They don't control their own time, their own personal and their own social time. And this idea to have this to expand the time sovereignty is very strong and very interesting. And this means that we should think on different policy, public policies. We have to think on different new. Maybe we should think on a new generation of public policies, and this notion that people are losing their control of their own time is very strong. And so how to include this dimension of time in the public policies? I think this is very interesting, and through the organization of labor, to regularization of labor, of work is one of the ways of doing that, as of course, for instance, social democracy and so on made in the past. So basically, this is my presentation. I'm sorry for the data. Maybe it was too much information. And also I would like to apologize that unfortunately I would have to leave
because I have a class at the beginning at 6, so I have to leave basically now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Miguel do Carmo. You gave us a lot of food for thought. I think that the presentation will provide us a lot of important topics to discuss particularly in the final part of this conference. I will now hand the virtual floor to Sophie Duha, PhD candidate at the University of Amsterdam, and she's going to talk to us about social policy. Okay, so Sophie.
Yeah, thank you very much. I will start my PowerPoint presentation. Okay, yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Amsterdam, and I do my PhD research on the European Pillar of Social Rights. So this is really the newest EU flagship social policy initiative. And today I want to introduce a bit this EU social policy initiative that we have now since 2017, but that is still relevant and broadly used by the EU to foster the social dimension. And I will concentrate mostly also on its implementation, and then also try to give an outlook. So what could the social pillar mean for the Portuguese presidency, but also what will be the role of the Portuguese presidency in the future of the European Pillar of Social Rights and its implementation. So the European Pillar of Social Rights is an interinstitutional proclamation of 2017 from the Council, the Commission and the European Parliament. It is a non-binding proclamation of 20 social rights and principles. Introduce here an overview of the social rights. And as you can see, it is largely pre-existent rights, rights that are already in the Charter of Fundamental Rights, in the European Social Charter, or in EU secondary law. But it covers really all areas. So we can also really see that it covers areas where the EU has competences, and it covers areas where the EU does not have competences. The goal of the pillar was really to set a compass. It is always called a compass, to provide a guide towards efficient and social and employment outcomes, to promote upward convergence in the Eurozone between the member states, and its rights and principles are really worded in a very accessible language. So we see that they're really formulated strongly as rights. And they have, on the one hand, an instrument that summarizes rights. So it basically fulfills the function, okay, what social rights do we have in Europe? But it also has in its wording often a forward-looking element. So which social rights do we want to achieve, in particular in the context of new challenges arising from societal, technological, and economic developments. The pillar was it is often called in a Brussels context, a brainchild of Jean-Claude Juncker. So in 2014, he announced that he wants to achieve a social triple A for the European Union, and the Commission shortly afterwards started its work on the European Pillar of Social Rights. What it did first was to initiate a broad consultation process. So it consulted with civil society organizations, social stakeholders, but also with the social partners, of course, on this new pillar initiative, which rights should be included in this initiative, and where should be the focus of social policy in the EU. I think what is also important to mention here is that at the beginning, the pillar was very much also seen as something to strengthen the social dimension of the European Monetary Union. So at the beginning, its territorial scope was very much limited to the euro area. This was only broadened afterwards. And it was very much seen at the beginning or conceptualized as something which, yeah, should give the eurozone a social dimension, which was, yeah, after the euro crisis and the growing discontent needed for the EU to have, to maintain its legitimacy. After this consultation process, the Commission came out with a proposal for the pillar, and a trialogue negotiation started between the Commission, the Parliament, and the Council. And it is really remarkable that they, all 28 member states at that time, the UK was still a member, managed to agree on the European Pillar of Social Rights. It was then proclaimed at the Gothenburg Social Summit in November 2017. And it was proclaimed at a really high level. So it was proclaimed by head of states. And just a little detail for legal nerds, this wasn't like not uneasy, because of course it's like a proclamation by the council, but it was proclaimed by the head of states. So of course head of states are not member of the council of the EU, so they also had to kind of empower head of states to do so. That's just a short side remark here. And the Juncker Commission already like then proceeded in implementing this European Pillar of Social Rights. So we saw a lot of initiatives coming out afterwards, and they were all also adopted, which is kind of remarkable in the social and employment dimension of the EU. So we had this directive on work-life balance for parents and carers, for example, or the directive on transparent and predictable working conditions. Of course, both directives only renewed pre-existent EU directives, so the Parental Leave Directive and the Written Statement Directive. So one could argue they were kind of also low-hanging fruits that were picked here. But nonetheless, it's kind of remarkable that this seemed to have really given a push to the European employment and social field. Important is also that it was, the and social scoreboard was added here to the European semester policy coordination process, where also the economic, macroeconomic, fiscal rules are coordinated, but also employment and social policy. And this social scoreboard is aimed at monitoring member state implementation of the European Pillar of Social Rights, because the pillar is addressed to the EU, but also of course to the member states, as the EU doesn't have competences in all fields. So the Juncker Commission finished its work. It got a lot of regulations, the new directives adopted. So what happened afterwards? Of course, there was the fear that, okay, if Juncker leaves, if it's like his initiative kind of, or his commission at least initiative, will the pillar disappear? And I think something which was really important here that kind of ensured that the pillar is here to stay was that in 2019, we had a high level commitment to the implementation of the European Pillar of Social Rights. So the European Council in its new strategic agenda for 2019 and 2024 announced four priorities. One of them was to build a climate neutral, green, fair and social Europe. And within this strategic agenda, it announced that the European Pillar of Social Rights should be implemented at the EU and member state level with due regard for respective competences. So what we then also had was that von der Leyen and the von der Leyen Commission from the beginning on really committed to this implementation of the European Pillar of Social Rights. Of course, the European Pillar of Social Rights is also built in this work. So it is work done where the new commission can build on. But what we also see is that maybe the new commission also recontextualizes a bit the pillar of social rights. So we do not see anymore the references to the EMU in the policy documents, but what we see is that von der Leyen, or what can be argued is that von der Leyen puts the European pillar of social rights more as her social strategy in for the environmental and digital and transitions that are to come, and also vis-a-vis the demographic changes. So the communication, for example, on a strong social Europe of 2020 of the Commission announced that the pillar is the social strategy that ensures that the transition to climate neutrality, digitalization, and demographic changes are socially fair and just. The von der Leyen Commission announced that in January 2021 or February 2021, it will come up with an action plan on the implementation of the European Pillar of Social Rights. And this is something which, yeah, a lot of social stakeholders argued already or called for that it should finally come. So something which really lines up principle by principle. How will we implement the European Pillar of Social Rights? What can Europe do? How will it support its member states? So this is to be expected to come out. Also in October 2020, the Commission came out with its proposal on a directive on adequate minimum wages at the European Union, which is, I mean, quite something new, innovative, that you legislate on this. However, of course, in the run-up to this directive, there were quite some discussions, in particular with northern countries, that worried about their collective agreements and collective bargaining systems. So this directive, in its current proposal, won't set a level of minimum wages. For example, minimum wages have to be 60% of the gross median average wage. But it sets binding criteria. It also aims to strengthen social dialogue, collective bargaining. It doesn't apply to countries that do not have a statutory minimum wage. So this is clearly a message also to northern countries and their strong collective bargaining system. And it will also set a target of 70% of workers should be covered by binding agreements, collective agreements, which at the moment only applies to 9 EU countries. The Commission also started a consultation on a child guarantee. This will probably be integrated in the European semester. So really to ensure that member states do more on child poverty measures, that children get the necessary services they need. The Commission proposal came also up with a new proposal of with a reform of the youth guarantee. So up until now, young people until 25 are guaranteed to get a new offer when they leave formal education or lose employment, and this age group should now be up until 29. It also announced a European unemployment reinsurance scheme, although there's not yet a date set for it when we can expect it. However, what the Commission also did, and I think this is also really important, is that it really integrated the EPSR also in its European Green Deal, as I said, the social strategy, but also in its COVID-19 response. So what we have now is the SURE. So this mechanism, this support to mitigate unemployment risks in an emergency mechanism, it basically, the EU grants loans to member states within this COVID-19 pandemic emergency situation to support their short-term unemployment schemes. And there we also find the pillar in the policy documents or in the recitals, for example, setting up this regulation. The pillar is also directly integrated into the hopefully soon to be started recovery and resilience facility. So this part of this huge EU budget where the EU Commission can borrow money on the investment market for the first time directly and allocated among member states for their investment plans. And here, is the pillar in particular, in these policy documents in particular, named as to ensure that the social impact is seen by member states. They are invited to explain how the investments within this recovery and resilience facility contribute to the implementation of the European Pillar of Social Rights. I will end my presentation on a little outlook. So what could this pillar mean for the Portuguese presidency? Or also, what could be the role of the Portuguese presidency? So the German, Portuguese, and Slovenian Council in their TRIO program already committed to also implementing the principles of the Pillar of Social Rights. And they also announced an EU social summit in Portugal. So this will take place in Porto in May. And of course, I'm a bit restricted to English sources. Nonetheless, we probably can expect that the Portuguese presidency, of course, it will host the social summit, but will also play an important role. For example, last month, at the end of October, Commissioner Schmidt, so the Commissioner for Unemployment and Social Affairs, announced that the former Portuguese Labour Minister Vieira da Silva will be his special advisor and help him to prepare the action plan on implementing the European Pillar of Social Rights. We also already have a draft resolution of the Employment Committee of the European Parliament that really calls for this social summit to set up something similar to, for example, the European 2020 strategy. So really a comprehensive strategy. And what we could see here is that the European Parliament calls member states that they should take a double approach. So first of all, of course, focus also on the sustainability part of the Sustainable Development 2030 agenda, while at the same time paving the way for the materialization of the EPSR principles, setting up ambitious targets and instruments. And in this resolution, they already called it the Porto targets and the Porto agenda. And for example, one of these targets that they call for is a commitment to a zero gender pay gap by 2013. So quite ambitious targets also. To conclude, I think we can, from a social policy perspective, I'm looking very much forward to the Portuguese presidency. And I think that we will hear from the pillar in the Portuguese presidency's program and work, and also on this new social summit, which is also, I think, something quite remarkable, because this will be this second social summit within 5 years. And before that, we had a social summit in 1997. So we also see that these, like, the heads of state meet up to discuss social policy issues seem to come more often. Thank you very much for the invitation, attention.
Thank you very much, Sophie. Made a really interesting overview of the developments so far, and also opening up the issues for the future. And since we in Portugal tend to like giving Portuguese city names to these EU targets, it's interesting that following the Lisboa agenda, that now we will have a Porto agenda in the future. So we will stay tuned for that. So thank you, Sofia. I will now give the floor to Professor Benedita Queiroz. So Benedita, take it away.
So good afternoon, everybody. Once more, I want to thank this invitation to participate in this very timely initiative, in particular to Professor Miguel Mori Silva, but I also want to greet the rest of the panel, Sophie Durat and Anahita Gil, and all the other participants in the event. It is a real pleasure to be here today. So the topic of my presentation will mainly focus basically on the concept of solidarity within the new Pact on Migration, which was presented in September. And then I will reflect rather on this matter. But this is where I'll start. This is the question or the main topic I will address. But let me tell you how I will structure my presentation. So firstly, I'll start with a brief introduction. Then I'll question whether we have a solidarity crisis and which are the variables of this crisis. And then I'll zoom in and talk about this new pact on migration, and in particular in the new solidarity mechanism. And from there, I will conclude on certain challenges that can be posed as well to the Portuguese EU presidency. So without further ado, today is, I think we're all aware, the EU faces several crises, several serious crises. We started 2008 with economic crisis, social crisis, then we had a migration crisis that started but is still not over. And now we are facing a health and sanitary crisis and also a rule of law crisis, which was already mentioned in the introduction. All of them have transversely a solidarity issue. So, and if we think about the migration crisis, the solidarity mantra has been repeated over and over again, and it's been portrayed as a panacea solution for the issues that have erupted mainly in 2015, but even before. And an example of that at the universal level were the UN compacts on migration and refugee. They also used the language of solidarity and fair share of responsibility. And as you might know as well, they have lost some strong supporters along the way. So this gives us a clue of where we are in terms of solidarity and migration. But let's focus in the EU, because that's the topic that we are looking at today. So the Commission has been clear about this. There's currently no effective solidarity mechanism in place and no efficient rule on responsibility. These were words of the EU Commission about the situation on migration today. And the consequences of the lack of a proper effective solidarity mechanism are well known to all of us. It's just a matter of opening the news and we can see the deterioration of the centers of reception for migrants and refugees and asylum seekers, such as Moria and Flames. It's a very unfortunate image that we might all have. But not only that, there are structural issues that portraying this solidarity crisis in migration, such as the processing of the claims, both for refugees, but also once these asylum seekers have the claim rejected, how long does it take for a return decision to be enforced? And how long do people have to stay in these precarious situations? And also, of course, with a rise of populism, we also have a bigger concern and the bigger marginalization of migrants as a category of people. In this context, the European Commission was very eager to say we're going to have a fresh start in migration and asylum, and the principles of fair share responsibility, sharing of responsibility and solidarity will be the pillars that will guide the reconstruction of the system. So this is where we were. And the Commission had a concern, which was move from the Dublin rhetoric. So the Dublin rhetoric, it means the Dublin system, the Dublin regulation, which was the main instrument that was used to attribute responsibilities in terms of processing of asylum claims, just to make it easier. So one of the moves of the Commission was actually changing the name. So this was a formal move, which it works if you are not attentive, if you don't read the substance. So now we have the Asylum and Migration Management Regulation being proposed. And you ask me, Is it a new document? Well, it's new, but it mirrors the status quo to a large extent. So the infamous criterion for attribution of responsibility, that one that talks about the first entry criterion, is kept in Article 21 of this new regulation. And so there's not such huge change. Well, there are certain changes, but they are not systematic. They're not groundbreaking in terms of changing the logic of the system. And so the promises of abolishing Dublin made by the president of the commission and the fulfillment of the new regime were a bit watered down, and we had to find some hope elsewhere. So everybody was putting some high hopes in this, this new shiny solidarity mechanism. And let me tell you about it. So as you know, or maybe you don't know, but you will know now, the new EU Pact on Migration and Asylum was put forward on the 23rd of September 2020. And interestingly, this marks the fifth anniversary of that decision on relocation of migrants from Greece and Italy, that you may know that some countries were not so happy with, and such as Hungary or Poland or Czech Republic. And this is an image or a reflection of the appetite of certain member states for enhanced solidarity in the area of migration. Well, if we fast forward to 2020, the Court of Justice has in April decided a case against the Commission against Poland, Hungary and Czech Republic, where it decided that they had violated their obligations under EU law, because they did not want to relocate migrants, right? This was what happened. And very interestingly, the court in its decision highlighted the fact that in principle, the shared responsibility of relocating migrants and sharing the responsibility with Italy and with France had to be divided between all member states. So, and the court reaffirmed as well the principle of solidarity and fair sharing responsibility between member states, and said this is all in accordance with Article 80 of the TFEU, which governs asylum policy. So we can see from here that the court has set the ground, and then the commission later in the year has followed with a proposal for a solidarity scheme, and this matters. This solidarity scheme is very complex, I have to say, and I will try and make it as simple as I can. And in very general terms, this intricate system comprises two types of situations. So firstly, actually even three types, but under regular circumstances, solidarity remains voluntary. Okay, and then we have situations where it can become mandatory for member states, but in a flexible way. It's in times of crisis. And the proposal divides these times of crisis in an escalation level. So we have, firstly, situations of migration pressures, and this is the lowest level of crisis, let's say. And within this scenario, which is left for the Commission and the EU agencies to decide whether it's happening or not, solidarity mechanism obliges member states to participate with solidarity contributions and according with the criteria, which is 50% chiefly population and 50% GDP. These contributions can be through relocation, return sponsorship, which means that one member state can sponsor returns in another member state, okay? And so it means as well that if that member state that sponsored the returns of a migrant in another member state, if after 8 months it didn't happen, it has to host that member state in its own territory. So you can see the confusion that that would be set up by this. And then there's the possibility for other contributions. Other contributions may range from capacity building to operational support. And you may ask, well, are these other contributions, such as financial support or even sponsoring returns, comparable to relocation, which is actually processing the claims for asylum. So just one question that I may launch. And then we have this other crisis situation. So we started with the not so serious, and now we have crisis situations, which is the highest level in this escalation. Well, within these crisis situations, what we have is that the pact determines that it would be mandatory for member states either to relocate migrants or to sponsor returns, and they could not contribute through the other means of contribution that I've just mentioned. So capacity building or operational support would not be possible. This crisis, this highest level of crisis, would comprise, for example, mass arrivals of irregular migrants, political crisis, or also crises which were sparked by a cause of force majeure, such as a pandemic. So you can see that it would be relevant for us today. And other than this, within this regime, what we would have would be a lowering of standard procedure of the protection within the standard procedures for asylum and return, such as, for example, further expanding the use of detention or deciding on the merits of a certain application during border procedures, or carrying out expulsions to any third country where the person has transited. But there's not only bad things, there's also the possibility in this proposal that member states could grant immediate protection status without need for examining the international protection claim. Well, this was already possible under the Returns Directive, so it's actually not such a novelty now that I think about it. With promises of a fresh start and shared responsibility, we've arrived here with this proposal. And you may ask me, well, is this, what's the balance of this proposal in terms of, does it reach the objectives it's set, that the Commission set it for? Well, some argue that this proposal is mainly a pragmatic proposal, that it doesn't really set new principles, it doesn't really look into the substance of what needs to be changed. And actually this pragmatic view of migration and of addressing migration issues is actually a trend that you can even see in the jurisprudence of the Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg very recently in detention cases. This was the language of the court as well, when it referred to practice of Hungarian authorities in that detained migrants in transit zones. And then the view was also a pragmatic view to migration. And I leave you with regards to this aspect, with this reflection, whether we should look into a pragmatic view or whether of migration or whether a more principled view, principle-oriented view to try and change the status quo. But, well, so what I've said, I believe, raises several challenges to the EU, but in particular to the Portuguese presidency of the EU, and raises many eyebrows. And let me tell you about the challenges that I think are worth mentioning, are worth noting, and I believe that you will be able to point out many more. So firstly, the pact promotes differentiation between member states. The fact that the Commission moved away from a mandatory system of relocation allows for this concept of solidarity between states to member states to opt out from granting the right to seek asylum in certain situations. They can buy their way out of it, basically. This leads me to my second point, which is the new pact on migration and asylum risks shifting responsibility from hosting refugees from the geographically disadvantaged countries, such as Italy, Greece, even Spain, to economically disadvantaged countries. And so this flexibility of choice could shift the burden of hosting refugees, the burden or the responsibility, let's say responsibility, I like it more, And the proposal, in fact, addresses this issue by prorating member states' expected contributions according to GDP and population. Although the decision to value each factor equally may not compensate for the structural differences in response capacity of the member states. So think Sweden and Portugal. They have similar population size, but in terms of spending power is quite different, right? And so it's worrying that one of the consequences could be this. Thirdly, and very importantly in my view, is the fact that the pact's notion of solidarity makes no attention to individuals themselves. So undocumented migrants, applicants to benefit to international protection are not really taken into consideration. And if we think about what I've said before, so situations such as relocation of these migrants and the sponsoring of the returns, the fact that there are several moves that will be done within EU members without taking into consideration any legitimate concerns of the individuals, it could be quite worrying, to say the least, because the migrant would be jumping around from one member state to another member state where maybe they don't have any ties. Okay, but maybe this is a collateral effect that we are okay with. I'm just raising some questions. And worryingly as well, the pact does not make any reference to the fact that member states should not be able to select these migrants based on criteria such as nationality, ethnic or origin or religion or even integration potential. And here, I believe that it's quite straightforward that it would be a violation of discrimination, which is prohibited under EU law. Fourthly, and I think also interestingly, this flexible solidarity, mandatory at times, would also be able to empower governments such Hungary and Poland, which are currently being under the supervision of the EU, either under Article 7, but they were also there were also infringement action proceedings against them, and so it's quite worrying that member states like this would be able to maybe go around certain policies and get away with their xenophobia and discrimination. Well, I don't want to finish this in such a sad note, but I'm not a huge optimist about the current situation on migration. And let me just tell you that all in all, this concept of flexible solidarity, in my view, can be problematic if it's not rethought. And I think this is one of a big task of the Portuguese presidents of the EU. Not only it can lead to fragmentation within the European cooperation on this matter, which should be basically a common action, but also it's not good enough if we're trying to achieve the promises of changing a disastrous status quo to a more human and humane approach, as the Commission put it. Because if in the face of all Europe's current crisis and the future crises, which are already announced, there's a huge economic crisis uprising. A weak remedy like this, like the pact, which is embedded in intergovernmentalism, will lead to more challenges rather than solutions. And the Portuguese presidency will have to face some of them. And with this, let me thank you for your patience. And I look forward to the debate. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Bendita. It's interesting because Europe obviously has an historical responsibility in terms of particularly dealing with refugees. We had two world wars in the past century, plus more localized wars. It's enough to think of the war in former Yugoslavia, not to mention in the eastern borders with Russia. And so it's we do have sort of this historical debt, but then And we have a principled approach set out in international law. It's interesting to see that to some extent, all this discussion of flexible solidarity sort of brings out this pragmatic approach, obviously, but it really stands in contrast with what we learn in international law and the Convention on Asylum, and asylum being sort of this fundamental guarantee, one of the few that international law really gives to individuals. It's sad to see that we now have this ability to pay to avoid dealing with responsibility. Particularly, I'm talking about asylum seekers. And as we know, this is obviously something very controversial. We've had this debate during the U.S. Election campaign, distinguishing between asylum seekers and sort of economic migrants, etc. So thank you, Bendita. I just forgot to share something with you. I had promised that I would have some questions. So let me just show you, starting with the questions on social policy. Okay, so there are two questions. The first question, should the EU set binding minimum levels based on which national minimum income standards or minimum wages must be calculated? So should we have minimum binding levels in terms of estimating minimum wages and so this is the question, do you agree, yes, no, or if you're still thinking about it and you need to think more about it, then I have a third option for you just in case, okay? The second question is whether you support a long-term European-wide solidarity mechanism that would provide funding to national unemployment insurances in case of economic crisis. So this would be something that is also connected with EMU in the sense that an economic and a monetary union implies that you do have mobility of factors, but within our social model, that should also mean that we should have mobility of social protection as well, and the sharing of the burden of this social protection, something which in a continental economy like the United States is taken as a given, despite obviously the level of protection being much different from the one we have in Europe. So again, the question is, do you support this mechanism? Do you not support it, or do you need to think more about it? So in order to participate in this survey, all you need to do is go to this website, menti.com, okay, and use this code. There will be a different code for each of the surveys that I will present to you. So please write down this this code now, because I'm going to show you the next set of questions that were put forward by Bernadita. Okay, I would also ask you to keep the microphones off, please. Keep the sound off, because often there was an interruption earlier on in the beginning, so please keep the microphones off, okay? Right, so I hope everyone has taken note of this, so we're already getting results, there's one result already. Let me now shift to the other questions dealing with migration. Okay, let me just move around these windows. Okay, so. Yeah, this is the one. Okay, so now the first question, do you support the notion of flexible solidarity as proposed by the EU Commission in the EU Pact for Migration? As we've seen, this is a form of pragmatically dealing with the more obstructive action of some member states, allowing them to pay in order to avoid responsibilities that, in fact, the EU is very likely unable to actually exercise or to bring this responsibility to some form of consequence. So that's the first question. Now, note that let me just close here this. Note that the code now is different, so you need to use this different code to take part in this second survey, okay? Let me just show you the second question. What should be the priority of the Portuguese presidency of the EU in this area. And the question is whether it should be focused on the individuals or guaranteeing a fair balance between responsibility sharing and solidarity among member states, for example, by setting aside the Dublin rationale, creating new legal pathways through pivotal sponsorship schemes, that was also mentioned by Bendita, or other. I just wanted to leave it open that, you know, Bendita presented these three alternatives. I just wanted to leave it open to you, okay? So these are the questionnaires. So please, you can continue to vote, okay? It's okay to continue to vote. We will now move to Ana Rita Gil. And so I give you the floor now, Ana Rita.
Thank you very much. And I would like first to congratulate Professor Bas Ferreira and Professor Miguel Mori Silva for these initiatives, which are of the most importance in this context and to debate the Portuguese presidency. As Benedita, we actually divided our presentations. I will focus on the EU Pact on Migration, but with a different perspective, because I will focus on the optimistic measures and not pessimistic measures, which may raise also some issues. So let's go. I'm going to share the screen with you. I don't know if it's already. Okay. Yeah, I think that you can see it now. So, okay. So I'll dip in on migration social rights. Not only on the migratory procedure, but also once they arrive to the host country. So the big challenge, as Benedita said, was to implement this new pact. So we had this present when we start the Portuguese presidency, which is to start with the first measures to apply this pact. So I think that we should take a deep look at it, because it will be very challenging. So I will focus first on protection of social rights at the border. So at the border, when a migrant arrives at the border, should have immediately some social rights because he needs to live in a dignity manner in the border. Then social rights in the host member state. So when the migrant arrives to the host member states, and then I'll discuss a little bit about a proposal that seems very optimistic to me, which is to decide about a legal labor migration directive, which is something that member states have not yet been willing to adopt between themselves. So I don't know if this will start, the first kickoff will be on the Portuguese presidency. Let's see what the future will bring us. So I'll just start with this is a principle that is enshrined in the Treaty of Functioning of the European Union, which is the common policy on migration has a pillar which is must be fair towards third country nationals. And this should be applicable also to social rights. So there is, we can say, a tendency for equality in the difference, if I can be myself clear. So in principle, migrants should have the same access to social rights, or at least they should have a fair access to social rights in the EU. Let's start with the social rights at the border. What do I mean with this? I mean that when migrants arrive at the border, let's think about Lampedusa or the island of Lesbos, immediately they should be awarded with some basic human rights. And actually, this is something that is enshrined on a specific directive that it's already in force in the European Union. And we call it the Reception Conditions Directive. So this directive sets forth a set of conditions that must be awarded to migrants once they arrive to the European Union. They have to receive it in a dignified manner. That means, for example, the right to have housing, even if temporary housing, the right to have access to healthcare, the right to have access to social protection, And this is immediately once they apply for asylum. So they apply for asylum and immediately this directive is applicable and they have to be awarded with some social rights, even if they don't have yet a legal status. However, after 2015, I think it was the peak of the refugee crisis, these border states did not have the capacity to provide all these migrants. I'm thinking about there were some days where they were faced with more than 1,000 entry per day. They could not award all these migrants with these social rights. It was impossible. They did not have sufficient accommodation capacity to the high numbers of migrants that were seeking to arrive into their shores. So we've seen the images in the television, we've seen the children sleeping on the streets, we have seen the migrants in big queues just to apply for asylum, we have seen them being detained in the big detention centers, so it was impossible to respect these reception conditions directly. So the pact, as I said, I'm talking about optimistic solutions. So the pact provides for some answers to these problems. First, let's not think that this crisis will end soon, because all the origins of the crisis are maintained. So the conflicts in Syria, the lack of security in Eritrea, Libya, and so on, will continue, irrespective of pandemic or not. So, of course, this pact had to provide some answers to the continuation of these mass influxes. And it tries to provide some good measures. One of the measures is to provide a strong response to vulnerable migrants. So what the pact claims and puts forward is to, when we have this big mass of migrants arriving, you should at least look to the most vulnerable, normally, for example, unaccompanied children. And at least these accompanied children cannot be detained. So this is the first measure, no detention for children. And they should have been appointed immediately with a guardian. This was another big fault in the first wave of the refugees, was that there were not enough guardians for all the unaccompanied children that were arriving. So we had these problems that we had like 9,000 migrant children that were disappearing from the refugee camps. So this is like a very optimistic perspective, which is to implement a guardianship system. So this is like the first challenge that will be, that will appear in the Portuguese presidency, complementing, of course, what Benedita says, okay? So as regards my presentation, this is the first big challenge, is to have an EU-based guardianship, let's say, league for all member states, so that all unaccompanied children have the right to have a guardian. So let's see if this will be easy to implement. Things are very good in the law in books. Let's see how it will be in the law in practice. Secondly, as Benedict already said, it also sets for what they call force majeure, a response to a massive influx of migrants. Here, the objective is also to provide temporary protection to all those people that are arriving. And the pact claims that all of those that are arriving from conflict zones should be awarded with temporary protection that will last for 1 year. And with this temporary protection, they may have access to social rights, so accommodation, health, education in the member states. Also here, I have some doubts So Portugal will have here a very critical role so that member states will accept this 1 year temporary protection. As Benedita said, some of us will happily accept, but as regards, for example, the Visegrad group, and we have to say it, it's not like a public shaming, but we have to say that the Visegrad group, we will have a tough job to convince them to provide this immediate protection to these refugees. So moving now from the border into the host state. So at the border, they don't have yet a status, but then they will acquire, in principle, if they are refugees and not economic migrants, they will acquire a legal status, either a refugee status or a subsidiary protection status. And once they have the legal status and they go to the host country, they will have access to this country's social rights. And the pact also has increased these social rights. So this is my optimistic perspective. I have to remind you of this. So I'm talking just about the good things. It has increased some of the social rights. First, family reunification. So these migrants will have an enhanced right to family reunification. For example, it was not allowed until now, but the pact claims that it should be adopted now, a directive or amending the family reunification directive in order to admit that refugees can bring more family members than they were so far allowed to bring. For example, siblings or people that they met during the migratory procedure. And they, for example, have married with them in Jordan or something like that. So family reunification is enhanced. Well, of course, this rule, this principle has to be discussed and decided at the parliament and at the council. So again, I'm not sure that despite the pact's willingness to enhance family reunification, I'm not sure if we will have a new directive on this topic. It will be very tough for the discussion of this subject and to adopt or to start to discuss. It will be started in the Portuguese presidency. So I'm not, of course, it will not be finished, the conversations, because these immigration issues normally take years, 1 year, 2 years to be formally decided. On the second hand, there is also the willingness to adopt a EU plan on inclusion and integration. So EU has decided that inclusion and integration of migrants in the host country should be harmonized in all member states. So this will be another conversation to start now during the Portuguese presidency. And despite his optimistic view of the pact, I'm also quite skeptical about the success of this, because member states have so far reserved to themselves the exclusive competence to deal with integration. Each member state wants to decide if they need a language test, if they need a culture test, if they are, if they have the same rights to access to schooling, do they have the need to do a special exam or not? So until now, this is one of the topics that is very sensible. And well, another very sensible topic to start to be discussed as regards migration and access to social rights and integration. But the most, how can I say, the most striking proposal is to adopt a directive on admission and residence for work purposes. So this is the thing that Benedito was saying, to open legal channels for migrants. This is something that has been discussed since 2015, when we had this peak of refugees arrivals. The Commission, when it enacted the 2015 agenda on migration, already stated that we could only fight against illegal immigration if we were willing to open more legal channels. Until now, we couldn't have, we just didn't manage to do it. Because, as I said again, member states want to keep this issue to their own sovereignty. It's easier to arrive to a conclusion in what regards family reunification or, for example, temporary workers. We have already a directive on temporary workers. Or, for example, on seasonal workers and so on. But has a directive that really compass all entries for work purposes, this is at the very core of a migration policy. And until now, member states, and we are discussing about, let's say, 20 years, I'm talking about 20 years, in 20 years, member states did not achieve a commitment about harmonizing their laws as regards work migration. So this EU Pact on Migration and Asylum decided very bravely, okay, it's time to start discussing work migration, and we should do it now. So this will be my perspective, besides the solidarity mechanism that Benedita has so well explained to us. I think that this will be the biggest challenge as regards migration, to start conversations under the Portuguese presidency on which type of migrant workers do we need in the European Union. Okay, so as a conclusion, I have to say that, as I mentioned, this was the optimistic point of view of the pact. It's a very ambitious program, and we will have a very tough road ahead with many thorny questions. We have the problem as regards the temporary protection for 1 year with access to social rights of migrants. We have the need to harmonize our integration and inclusions of migrants and to achieve a consensus or a majority in all EU member states. And we know that European Union is very divided as regards immigration. And then we have this new duty, which will be to arrive to a directive that will regulate migration for work purposes, which is economic migration. So let's see how Portugal will cope with this, with the starting of these discussions. Of course, none of these instruments will be adopted in this 6 months period, but I'm pretty sure that the discussions will start, and they are very sensitive. So we should wait and see how it will be going. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Narita. And all the speakers so far have been quite precise in using the allocated time. So I thank you for being concise in transmitting your remarks. Before we move on, I'm going to make the final survey available. I just used the chat to refer you to the new code, and I'm going to try and show the question here on the web page. Let's see if I get it right. Okay. Right. So the first question is, should the EU harmonize the conditions to admission and residence of foreign workers in all member states? So this is one of the optimistic perspectives put forward by Enrita. And again, yes, no, or I need more time to think about it. The second question is, should groups of asylum seekers benefit immediately from a year-long residence permit allowing them access to social rights in the EU? So a more controversial one, and the first vote is no. Okay, well, that's a yes. So we'll keep track of that. Let me go back now to the other questions we've made before and see how the voting has gone, and that will give us hopefully some food for thought. In the meantime, I've received another question here on the chat panel. I will try to place it to you, but before that, let me just see how things are on social policy. Okay, only three. Let's see. Which one? Oh, okay, there we go. All right, so don't be afraid to take part in this. We will, you can vote for the next 2 days. So if you don't know what is the sense you want to vote, you can vote in the next 2 days, and we can try and make this the results available online, okay? This is completely anonymous. I forgot to tell you at the beginning, maybe that would have created another incentive to take part in this. This is completely anonymous, okay? So there's no tracking of your data, all right? So if you're concerned with privacy, it's fully privacy compliant. Okay, so we have here a balance. So should the EU set binding minimum levels based on which national minimum income standards or minimum wages must be calculated? 3 votes for yes and 2 for need to think about it a little bit more. And for the second question, let's see, do you support a long-term European-wide solidarity mechanism to fund unemployment insurance in the case of economic crises? And 4 votes yes, and 1 that needs to think about it. So again, no opposition apparently to these 2 proposals. So Sophie, what's your reaction to these results?
Well, so to the second, actually, it's not surprising because other research was done on this, and it seems that European-wide, there's really support for these European-wide solidarity mechanism, not only within countries like Portugal or Spain, but even in Germany. Support grows, and let's hope that the Commission starts doing something on this needed solidarity within the Eurozone. On the minimum wage level, I think it's a good sign for the EU because there's no hard opposition. So we obviously trust the EU with setting fair minimum wage standards and minimum income standards again. I think it's a positive sign for the EU. I would have expected maybe given that under the crisis, the EU was not always fair to social rights, maybe. But maybe the last years of the COVID-19 response also now shows that EU takes more.
Yeah, the crisis response seems to be leading to more centralized EU level response. And so it's now positive just that we can ask the question and it is taken seriously. It's not dismissed as, you know, some lunatic proposal by a fringe group. It's something that is now in the mainstream debate, and obviously we will have to take some time to discuss this as well. Okay, so thank you. Let me now move on to the other questions that we have for Benedita. Okay, let me just share it here. Okay, so the first question, do you support the notion of flexible solidarity? And here, no. No support for flexible solidarity. This is obviously a very small sample, so it's really, we need to be careful with not really drawing major policy conclusions here. It's just to get a feel from the audience as to how they view these issues. Lita, comments on this question?
It's quite interesting to see. I like to see that there are some people who need to think about it more, and myself, I need to think about it more as well. I need to study it more. But I think it's also a good sign that there's some reaction on the no side. because my first impression as well after studying it is that it could really create bigger inequalities within member states. And so I think this reaction to the question goes in the same direction, I believe. For those for the person who said yes, it also shows that we need to find a balance between member states' interests and migrants' rights. And so I think there's the balance in the yes is the balance with the interest. So I think it's quite a balanced reaction to the question, quite positive.
Do you think that if we were to move towards even a more integrated response at the EU level, so where the EU would actually sort of have, for instance, the means to finance sort of centralized contributions, mm-hmm. and have sort of a EU budget to deal with migrants and asylum seekers, do you think that could change the dynamics? Because I feel that a lot of people are fearful that member states will, in the end, be left alone. This is just a form of burden sharing, where you know ultimately it will be you know the more stressed economies that are going to receive these migrants, or that will have to pay, and also the issue of cultural identity, something that is very much in the concerns of the more radically opposed countries like Poland and Hungary. Do you think that a more centralized approach could actually give some guarantee that there will be a fair share of the burden?
I believe that my first reaction to what you're saying is yes. What if we have a more centralized regime, we would feel like we have a stronger EU taking care of the situation. The issue of member states feeling like they will be left alone contributing and then having to deal with, for example, the issues with integration. I think issues with integration at first are very hard. I think we should separate them. One thing is that matter, which is quite, which is very important and has been a flag for all the populist and not populist, not every populist, but most government in the EU. And another thing is financial contributions. And I think that when we think about financial contributions, I think a more centralized action of the EU would be an advantage. When we talk about integration, I'm not sure which would be the tools that could be used for that. So my answer is a bit divided to your question. I don't have a straightforward answer, I think.
And Rita, do you want to pitch in with your views on this? Rita?
Maybe she's
not hearing me. Okay, well, let's move on to the next question and we'll come back to Enrita. Okay, so the next question, what should be the priority? And we have a tie between the two first possible answers.
I think a mixture, I think a combination between both would be great, to be honest. So a more balanced view of the pact would be great.
Mm-hmm.
Because
in a sense, it's the combination that you mentioned of a principled approach. Mm-hmm. So that would probably be answer number one, and the pragmatic approach. And that would likely be the answer number two, right?
Exactly. I think it's.
Okay. Yeah. Just a question that all these policies bind, they bundle two questions together, the issue of migrants and the issue of asylum seekers.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that these issues are correctly bundled together, or should they be unbundled? Because there are different, from an international law perspective, for instance, there are different rules regarding responsibility vis-a-vis migrants, and a particular responsibility vis-a-vis asylum seekers.
I think it's good that the solution combines both, because many times what we have is asylum seekers that were rejected, which should have been asylum seekers, and then they are considered irregular migrants. And so the cycle of migration is not so black and white as we may think. Here we have an economic migrant and we have an asylum seeker. No, actually they conflate many times, and they go through stages, and they go back to being irregular, and they go, and then they are asylum seekers. So in my view, I agree that the solution is to look into these phenomena together, but having different regimes for both. So the regime should be different. Either you are an irregular migrant, or you are an asylum seeker, or you are an economic migrant. So, and I understand that from a perspective of international law, this actually links with the perspective of international law, which says that you are a refugee if you fit the conditions of the Geneva Convention of 1951, right? And so if we agree with that, if we agree with the declaratory status of refugees, then we should assume that some have not had their claims duly processed. And so my view is more holistic, and I think it should be looked together, although the treatment should be different.
Okay, thank you very much. And Rita, do you want to pitch in on these two questions?
Yes, I'm sorry, there was a blackout. I live in a village. It went down. So
inequalities in access to the internet.
That's I'm facing that problem. So what should be the priority of the Portuguese presidency in this area? I cannot see, but I think it.
And we've lost Anarita.
No, I'm here.
Oh, you're here. Oh, okay. Yeah, I just let you in with another connection. Okay, right.
So the individual greater protection on human rights.
So the individuals, a greater focus on the protection of migrant rights, guaranteeing a fair balance between responsibility sharing and solidarity among member states, and three, creating new legal pathways.
Yeah, I think that
I'm just going to turn off the sound on the other. Okay, it's okay,
no,
I can
just
I need to turn off the sound. Otherwise it makes a feedback effect.
I think that now I can, yes, now it's, I'm so sorry for this. It's That's okay. Why living in small villages has this problem. I live in Auschwitz, which is in the other
side. That's the problem. I live in Lisbon. Occasionally the net just falls. And...
So I'm not surprised with this, creating new legal pathways. For example, private sponsorship. We do not have that tradition in the EU. This is a Canadian and more a Canadian tradition than US. So I think it's something, I don't know if Benedict has already mentioned anything about this. So I understand that this might be a little bit strange for people. This is a solution. However, as for fair balance, I think it was one of the biggest problems during all this time was this lack of fair balancing. And we heard that we were very, very, very unhappy because some member states did not agree at all to receive anyone. So this was a bigger crisis, and the Europeans looked at that like these people, these countries did not even deserve to be part of the European Union. If they are not willing to have some responsibilities, they should be out. So this crisis, this solidarity crisis, how Benedicta mentioned, reflects on these votes. That's why people are claiming for more solidarity. Yeah, and the individuals, of course, we need to provide more individual rights. And this is not just a matter for individual rights, it is also a matter for public order. The more you integrate, the more the society will be pacific and will be ordered. So this is not just a matter for individual rights, it is a matter of public concern. So that's what I would like to say about this. And I'm so sorry for all these confusions.
Let me move on to another question. We have one, it's a great question. Unfortunately, Professor Loknato is not here. The question, I think we will take that up later on. Will social inequalities caused by the pandemic be larger than the ones caused by the financial crisis? Mm-hmm. This is more of an empirical economic question, and all of us here remaining in this part of the panel are lawyers. So I would propose that we adjourn that, because I think Professor Manuel Carvalho da Silva will have an interesting things to say about this question. I have my own view, but again, I'm a lawyer. Okay, so let me move on to more specific questions that we have here. And we will return to the first question by Francisco Castelo Branco later on, okay? So I hope he can stay on with us till the end of the panel. Hugo Rufino Marques asks the question, European policies as to migrants will always discuss, so welcoming and supporting migrants, but not that much on how to integrate them and to respect the existing culture in Europe, and vice versa, how to respect the culture of these migrant populations. To impose on certain peoples the duty to welcome these migrants, will this not go against the self-determination right of the peoples? So we have this peoples sort of in a very international law type or international politics view, Europe of the peoples rather than the European Union. So what are your views on this? I would start with you, Ana Rita, and then go back to Vita and Sofia if you have something to say.
Thank you for the question. This is a very thorny one, and it goes deeply into the right of integration of migrants. So I think that integration is a bilateral procedure. So the society needs to provide tools to integrate. And on the other hand, the migrant has to move towards the society basic principles. So I'm very, I argue a lot that you should have to find a balance between what is required from the society and what is required from the migrant. There is something that for me is very sacred. We have fundamental values, we have fundamental pillars, such as equality, tolerance, and the rule of law. So everyone who enters into the EU has to respect these principles. So this is my normally people get very angry when I say this, but for me, it's something that you cannot negotiate. However, in order to be truthful to these principles, you also have to have tolerance towards migrants who have other religions. So as long as their religion, as long as their habits, as long as their culture does not go against our main and fundamental pillars, we should accept, we should tolerate, because our pillars are also tolerance and diversity. So as I said before, integrating is not just a matter of being very nice to the migrants. It's actually a matter of public interest. Let's think, for example, about France, who has failed to integrate some migrants and some second generation and third generation migrants, and have faced many challenges with some very serious consequences to its public order. So when we think about integration, we have to bear in mind these two things. Integration is from the two sides, not just the migrant, but also the society, not just the society, but also the migrants. And we have always these pillars that are the base of our society, that are the ultimate thing to be respected. So this is what I think about this issue.
Thank you. Benedita?
I'll just add something to the already very comprehensive answer that Ana Rita gave. the only thing I would add is if we look at it from an international law perspective, not only it goes against self-determination of peoples, I would actually say that it's a challenge for human rights. And so another thing we should, or another aspect that, that we should add to this equation is the fact that if the rights of these migrants are not respected in terms of integration and respecting their culture, or vice versa is a bit difficult, but I'm saying by the state to the migrants, they would always have as last resource the Human Rights Court in Strasbourg. So where the jurisdiction of the court also is competent to decide on cases where, for example, a state, which is a member of the Council of Europe, does not respect the standards, right? I will just add to this that it's also a legal obligation to respect the minimum standard of integration of these people. So I will just add that. Thank you.
Sophie, do you want to pitch in? It's not the topic you covered, but if you have something to say.
No, but indeed, like it's not really my field, so I'm not an expert in it. But what Henrietta said and Benedita seemed very, like I can only, agree to that.
And we can all subscribe to. Okay, so final question by Diogo Carvalhos. There's also a reference by Luisa Cavaco to Serigrafias Miró. I wonder if that is a comment to Benedita. Okay. So a final question then, what are the major difficulties in order to approve social measures in the current EU? And sort of the question goes around the relationship between the fundamental freedoms under the treaty, internal market and social policy at EU level. So Sophie, want to start?
Yes, so yeah, the basic problem is that member states are so divided on it. So there's always, like, I think three groups of member states. So there's like the, member states who do not want any social integration at all. These were mostly often the UK, but okay, the UK is out now, but these were member states like Poland or Hungary, for example, that are also incredibly difficult to agree on social standards. Then there was always the group of northern member states, which is always a bit ambivalent, because of course they're interested in they have a high social standard, so they're interested in that other member states converge, but they're also very protective of their collective bargaining system. And and then there's like a group of member states, France, I think Portugal as well, or Spain, who want more social integration. And basically finding a consensus between these member state groups and is extremely difficult. And this is the most problematic when it comes to higher social standards or labor standards. And then of course, when it comes to free movement, we have probably more clear division between the newer member states, so Central and Eastern European member states, and Western European states, where the Central and Eastern European states want more free movement, want access of their workers to other labor markets, want access of services to labor market, whereas Western member states are always a bit more protective of the system. And that was also something that we saw with the Posted Worker Directive that was renewed in 2018, where Poland and Hungary went, after it was adopted, directly to the Court of Justice, claiming that it should be annulled. This division among member states is extremely difficult, which is of course, also due to the EU, we have quite imbalances between social standards, and we have different welfare systems, which is also not easy to combine. So there are also like underlying factors in it.
Okay, so this topic could keep us going for hours. Let me just, because we still have two speakers, I don't want to cut on their time. Just quickly, so the questions that Anarita suggested, so should groups of asylum seekers benefit immediately of a year-long residence permit, allowing them access to social rights. We have five votes, four yes and one no. So that's interesting in terms of the support. And as to the other question, should the EU harmonize? We have just one answer saying no, we should not harmonize. Okay, let me just move on now. Thank you for your excellent presentations. I think it was a really great debate. And let me now move on to Portuguese and switch to Portuguese. E dar então a palavra ao Dr. Manuel Carvalho da Silva, que espero já agora, fica já este repto para esta questão de saber se as desigualdades que vão resultar da atual crise provocada pela pandemia vão ser, será que vão ser superiores às desigualdades causadas pela crise financeira? Tem a palavra, por favor.
Então, boa tarde a todas e todos os participantes e uma saudação especial ao professor Miguel Moreira Silva, ao professor Eduardo Paz Ferreira, a quem saúdo também como representação coletiva de um instituto que dá um contributo muito importante ao debate político em Portugal sobre políticas públicas, desde logo, mas também sobre temas outros, às vezes muito relevantes na sociedade. Eu julgo que responderei à questão que foi colocada numa das partes da reflexão que preparei para partilhar aqui convosco. Eu começo o meu contributo está arrumado em quatro pontos, com muitas subdivisões, e fui incorporando também aqui algumas notas que decorrem do painel a que assistimos. Primeiro, todos nós, fazendo um pouco um exercício de memória histórica, todos nós sabemos que aquilo que designamos por Europa Social foi construído na base de razões históricas, E com dinâmicas muito diversas, com interpretações diversas, mas muito diferentes, num contexto muito diferente do contexto em que hoje nos encontramos. A primeira questão que se coloca desde logo é, então, e esta Europa Social que foi construída nessas condições, tem condições de prosseguir num contexto muito diferente, onde, até do ponto de vista geopolítico e geoestratégico, as mudanças são profundas e alteram muitas das bases em que assentou a construção desta Europa Social ou deste modelo? Eu digo, acho que sim. Primeiro, é preciso defender esta visão que temos da dimensão do social e da relação profunda entre o social e as outras dimensões, desde logo a económica, mas há um exercício enorme de debate para defender o que está adquirido, não deixar que seja demolido e para renovar e projetar o futuro da dimensão social deste modelo que queremos. Entretanto, permitam-me, e esta é a primeira parte, o que disse foi apenas uma consideração, uma interrogação de partida. A primeira parte da minha reflexão é olhar um pouco o contexto que temos vivido nas últimas décadas. E eu já agora situo num ato em que tive a oportunidade de participar. Em 2004, muito pouco depois de Durão Barroso ter assumido a presidência da Comissão Europeia, havia uma prática com uma grande regularidade de realização de cimeiras sociais, em que estava presente sempre o presidente da Comissão Europeia e alguns outros comissários relevantes, e que reuniam com delegações da representação empresarial, patronal a nível europeu e com a representação sindical. E eu integrei, nessa altura, o grupo um grupo saído do Comitê Executivo da Confederação Europeia de Sindicatos, de que fazia parte, e, portanto, um grupo, salvo erro, éramos uns 7 ou 8, era a norma, que participávamos em representação da Confederação Europeia nessas cimeiras. E então, quando se iniciou a discussão e usámos da palavra, os sindicalistas usaram da palavra, defenderam um modelo social europeu, portanto, nesta expressão comum, todos partilhada, e a primeira reação de Durão Barroso foi dizer-nos: mas não há um modelo social europeu. Há 20 e tal modelos sociais europeus. Isto observado pelo facto de a União Europeia ser, na altura, constituída, já não me recordo exatamente o número, 20 e tal países, é uma realidade, digamos que é uma verdade lá para Alice, não é? Mas ele fez alguns acrescentos que apontavam um outro sentido desconstrutivo, que era o facto de haver diferenças entre os países e a tendência para equilibrar. Equilibrar como? Equilibrar numa lógica de harmonização no retrocesso. Estava feita a fotografia. Nós vinhamos de um período de forte afirmação de dinâmicas de negociação e dinâmicas reivindicativas, com manifestações europeias organizadas pelos sindicatos muito interessantes entre 2000, 2003, e também uma dinâmica de negociação com uma ação junto das representações patronais muito, muito forte e com aspectos interessantes. Ora bem, eu situo isto para vos trazer à reflexão. Como é que as coisas evoluíram a partir daí? O que é que nós temos, entretanto, a partir dessa afirmação de que não há um modelo social europeu, a expressão que tinha uma carga já fortemente marcada por visões ou por uma perspectiva neoliberal? Desde logo, há um facto. Os países, no geral, tornaram-se mais ricos, os produtos internos brutos cresceram, etc., mas, em regra, não se tornaram menos desiguais, quer do ponto de vista interno, quer do ponto de vista das relações entre os países. Há exceções e há aspectos a ponderar, num e noutro sentido, mas a primeira questão é esta. Segundo, a União Europeia não se tornou mais coesa e a afirmação de que, do ponto de vista social, não havia coesão, mas havia uma diferenciação, aprofunda-se ainda mais nessa lógica. Em terceiro, os processos migratórios e a pressão desses processos no contexto geopolítico, geoestratégico e de mudanças profundas no mundo que, entretanto, se viveram, criaram dinâmicas de pressão que são complexas e que precisam de ser profundamente analisadas. Em quarto lugar, nestas duas décadas, nós vimos surgir um crescendo de disfunções e rupturas nas relações entre gerações, até com promessas falsas feitas às novas gerações, né? Façam um esforço, formem-se, estudem, organizem-se, sejam empreendedores porque vão ser compensados e depois não são compensados em grande escala, e isto cria disfunções e rupturas nas relações entre gerações. E também este tempo foi também um tempo, e este é um quinto aspecto, de muita sobreposição do individual ao coletivo, que mata uma das bases fundamentais para a Europa social que queremos. Em quinto ou sexto lugar, que já me perdi, o que é que nós tivemos? Tivemos uma dinâmica de financiarização da economia, com mercantilização do trabalho e arrastamento dessa ideia da mercantilização também para o campo dos direitos sociais. Depois, depois um determinismo tecnológico crescente. As tecnologias têm imensa importância e imensa influência à evolução tecnológica, mas é bom termos noção de que as mudanças tecnológicas e os seus enormes impactos não são maiores em muitos aspectos, e, por exemplo, a sua influência sobre o social e sobre o económico, em muitos aspectos da realidade concreta de cada país em que vivemos, não são maiores do que os impactos das mudanças geopolíticas, geoestratégicas, das alterações que se impõem do ponto de vista das políticas ambientais, do ponto de vista do exercício do poder e de, nas nossas sociedades, a democracia perder densidade em várias dimensões, dos desafios que estão colocados face à própria evolução das tecnologias, mas não só, à evolução das sociedades, colocados à formação, ao ensino, à educação, tudo isso são alterações profundas. Eu há pouco falei da mercantilização do trabalho. Essa mercantilização esteve associada a um incremento muito forte de precariedades e de menor proteção e de fragilização da regulação do trabalho. Este é o contexto de onde vimos. Segundo grande tópico, a pandemia surgiu e o que é que nós vimos? Ela expôs vulnerabilidades. Expôs vulnerabilidades diversas, por exemplo, no caso português, é claro que tornou visível disfunções dos sistemas de emprego e da segurança social, tornou-se evidente a centralidade do trabalho e os desafios que se colocam ao seu ao trabalho no futuro, bem como uma relação profundíssima entre trabalho, emprego e sua qualidade e proteção social. Pois, mas nós vínhamos com uma dinâmica que não desapareceu, de desvalorização do trabalho. Eu coordeno um laboratório que, aliás, de que o IDF é associado, fundador, e continua a ser associado, que é o Colaborce, o Laboratório para o Trabalho, o Emprego, as Tecnologias e a Proteção Social. E uma questão que uma das pessoas mais destacadas com quem tivemos que dialogar no início deste processo nos dizia: sim, senhor, este laboratório pode ser muito interessante no contexto dos laboratórios colaborativos, mas vocês façam um esforço para substituir o conceito de trabalho, ou melhor, um esforço por criar, contribuírem para a criação de um conceito novo que substitua o trabalho por outra formulação, porque isto vai ser uma dispersão de atividades. Ora, o trabalho está aí central, mas a sociedade está minada. Por exemplo, uma das coisas que eu acho interessante, talvez pelo meu percurso profissional, é tratar todos os trabalhadores por colaboradores. Qualquer dia também preciso lá em casa de um colaborador pedreiro e de um colaborador canalizador. Vou mesmo precisar, proximamente. Mas, portanto, esta fuga a uma realidade que a pandemia colocou como uma evidência fortíssima, o trabalho é central, e as dimensões do individual e do coletivo no trabalho ou se reequilibram ou a coisa está muito, muito torta. E, portanto, a primeira ideia em relação à pandemia foi: a pandemia é democrática, mas ela só foi democrática no susto. E no mundo do trabalho e da proteção social, nós vimos que os choques foram de imediato profundamente assimétricos. Dentro de cada país, e no nosso muito em concreto, mas também entre os países. O que é que a pandemia trouxe? Trouxe um surgimento de medos, a necessidade de emergências, de definirmos políticas de emergência e de exceção, sem dúvida, até perante esta situação em que estamos agora, mais uma vez, em que temos que pôr alguns direitos em tensão para responder às exigências que se colocam na sociedade. induziu rapidamente uma pressão no discurso para o retorno à normalidade, com um entendimento da normalidade que era um retorno ao passado, que não existe, não existe, não há retorno ao passado. Vai haver, há que trabalhar o futuro em função das novas realidades, daquilo que se vai vendo e do que vamos assistir. E tivemos a União Europeia com respostas, digamos, com uma narrativa da crise, sem dúvida, no plano económico mais equilibrada que nas anteriores, no plano social, do ponto de vista de enquadramento geral, também relativamente mais equilibrado que na crise anterior, mas os países, os países não estão todos nas mesmas condições e, por exemplo, Portugal é um dos países do conjunto daqueles que já saíram da anterior crise mais desprotegidos, com uma dívida maior, e portanto nós sabemos que para haver proteção social é preciso dinheiro, desde logo dos orçamentos de Estado, mas é preciso dinheiro que venha do emprego, da qualidade do emprego e portanto, e da dimensão do emprego. E estes países, como Portugal, fizeram na outra crise sacrifícios que os tornaram mais pobres ainda, e muitos dos sacrifícios injustos, desde logo a ideia da solução da crise pela desvalorização do trabalho, e que não foi de todo arredada. E, portanto, estes países, como Portugal, ficaram mais expostos, com mais vazios, e isto aprofunda desequilíbrios que põem em causa o futuro da Europa social, desde logo com mais influência nestes países mais frágeis, mas em termos gerais. Ou seja, é hoje evidente que as respostas à crise, apesar desse enquadramento europeu relativamente melhor, e essa postura da União Europeia relativamente melhor do que face à crise anterior, o que é visível é que as respostas são mais ou menos robustas de acordo com os sistemas de proteção social existentes e com as condições financeiras existentes. Ora bem, e é aqui que, a partir desta realidade, que, e expostas as fragilidades, que eu não tenho aqui tempo de estar a expor, que nós devemos tomar algumas precauções. Nós não podemos projetar o futuro partindo estruturando, se quisermos, ou começando a desenhá-lo e a estruturá-lo, a partir das realidades de exceção que hoje vivemos. Elas têm que ser a exceção. Têm de ser tidas em conta porque as políticas de exceção expuseram muita coisa negativa e alguma também positiva, e isso tem que ser estudado, para além de estudar o que vem de trás e como é que o que vem de trás se transporta para a frente. Mas este contexto da crise tem que ser estudado, os seus impactos, etc. Mas esta não é a base da nova normalidade. Não pode ser. Não pode ser. E portanto, não podemos estruturar-nos sobre essas situações de exceção. Eu diria, a partir daqui, e entro no penúltimo tópico, que a pandemia mostra que o tempo é fator crítico. Nesta crise, esta é uma questão muito, muito sensível neste momento. E torna-se crescentemente fator crítico. O que é que nós vemos? Que debaixo da turbulência, das emergências, das exceções, dos medos, nós assistimos, isto para termos uma noção do que é que eu tento dizer quando digo o tempo é fator crítico. Nos primeiros dias da expressão oficial, formal já da crise, grande parte de trabalhadores precários foram despachados sem dó nem piedade. Não houve uma revolta mínima suficiente na sociedade a dizer isto não pode ser. O trabalho deles é tão valioso quanto o trabalho dos outros trabalhadores, como aliás o tempo demonstrou logo. Emergiu uma afirmação de, eu ouvi, de profissões essenciais e outras formulações sobre atividades no trabalho que são muito mal pagas e pouco valorizadas. E toda a gente a dizer isto não pode ser, até no setor da saúde, mas não só, naquilo que eram os setores que garantiam o funcionamento da sociedade, como os abastecimentos em diversas áreas, etc., na agricultura, etc. E isso durou pouco tempo, está esquecido. Não há uma preocupação com a valorização desses trabalhadores a que se chamaram trabalhadores essenciais. E há uma outra coisa importante a observar neste tempo, é que eu ouvi vários gestores e empresários, até em diálogo comigo, a falarem, a retomarem uma velha caracterização do setor produtivo e do setor não produtivo. E dos trabalhadores produtivos e dos não produtivos. E, por exemplo, conheço uma empresa, uma grande empresa no norte do país, que a determinada altura, umas semanas depois de entrar numa situação de gestão das medidas que eram necessárias e, portanto, colocando muitos trabalhadores em teletrabalho, começou a gerar, se eles tiveram que tomar medidas, uma tensão entre os que estavam no local de trabalho, que tinham que estar, e a empresa tem 1,000 e tal trabalhadores, não salvo erro 1,200 neste momento, e os que estavam em teletrabalho. E uma tendência para se cavarem rupturas. Este é um exemplo. É um dos pontos que eu gostava muito de desenvolver, mas não cabe aqui, porque a identificação de rupturas, ou se quisermos, de tensões fortes entre trabalhadores em diferentes condições, é um dos problemas a analisar. Depois, as atividades onde o trabalho é menos estável ou mais individualizado, como acontece na cultura e noutras áreas que foram postas em tensão, a desproteção é maior. Depois vemos que há muitas vezes uma primeiro, depois vemos que a representação coletiva dos trabalhadores, dos empresários, está muito mais fragilizada do que há 2 décadas atrás ou há 3 décadas atrás. As organizações estão mais frágeis e, em particular, as organizações dos trabalhadores, desde logo os sindicatos, enfraquecidos e com o senso comum a dizer-lhes que são tempos de emergência e de exceção e que se esqueçam das suas reivindicações. Que agora há que deitar a mão a outras coisas. Ora bem, isto é um problema, porque muitas vezes diz, desde que haja garantia de que há valores fundamentais que são protegidos, não há problema. Ora não, uma sociedade democrática precisa de valores e imperiosamente de representações coletivas que afirmem a dimensão do coletivo e que sejam responsabilizáveis na sociedade. Estas instituições de intermediação são absolutamente indispensáveis. E eu vejo com muita preocupação o que está a acontecer de enfraquecimento, desde logo, das organizações sindicais. E depois, há um outro aspecto, que é o desemprego a aumentar e a condicionar e a aprisionar cada vez mais. Depois, há normas na execução do trabalho que vão sendo impostas unilateralmente. Se não há organização e se não há diálogo e se diz, não, agora o que é preciso é responder à premência da situação que estamos e secundariza o diálogo e a negociação, o que nós temos é imposições unilaterais. E quanto mais tempo se prolonga estas situações de exceção e estes argumentários, mais se vai cavando uma situação caracterizada por quê? Por transformar dinâmicas resultantes desta vivência de exceções em formas de funcionamento instituídas para o futuro. Isto é perigoso. Deixo-vos uma referência em relação à legislação laboral, já agora. Estamos a falar de um instituto que pertence à Faculdade de Direito e está muita gente com certeza aqui, que, da área do direito, que é isto. Por exemplo, reclama-se, e eu também sou defensor, que se acelere alguma observação sobre o que é imperioso regular, por exemplo, em relação ao teletrabalho, às plataformas digitais, etc. Mas atenção, porque as leis que temos, desde o que está plasmado em alguns aspectos no Código de Trabalho até outras leis, se fossem efetivadas, era um salto imenso, já que, e tendo em conta que é preciso reajuste, etc., mas era um salto imenso. Ou seja, a nível nacional como a nível europeu, pode estar em marcha a aceleração da ideia de um novo enquadramento legislativo que toma a unilateralidade como base da sua formulação e o encantatório do que é novo para impor modelos que no futuro podem ser altamente questionáveis. E, portanto, esta é, julgo que com isto respondo à questão, já respondi também à questão que me foi colocada. E terminando mesmo, eu acho que, como eu dizia, o que é novo, e desde logo quando se introduz as tecnologias, o que é novo ainda aumenta mais a sua dimensão encantatória, e se não há um trabalho de análise profundo, distante, que se distancie dos medos e dos condicionalismos do que aqui falei e que analise com objetividade a realidade, isso torna-se uma armadilha muito grande. E é neste contexto que eu penso que é importante analisar alguns dos aspectos que já passaram aqui nesta conferência, na parte inicial, relativos ao pilar dos direitos sociais. O que é que se pode fazer? Porque há interpretações diametralmente opostas em relação àquilo que, pode representar o caminho do pilar dos direitos sociais, porque uma coisa é, simplificando, porque o contexto é absolutamente determinante e as relações que se estabelecem no contexto são absolutamente determinantes para ele ser ou não ser positivo. Acho que a presidência portuguesa da União Europeia tem, na observação sobre esta questão, na observação sobre o processo das migrações, etc., aqui uma agenda pesadíssima, mas que bem conduzida pode ajudar a fazer alertas no plano nacional e no plano europeu. E termino mesmo com isto. É só um minuto. Com esta situação que temos vivido, e por exemplo, até olhando os compromissos que o nosso governo tem assumido, eu quero dizer, e que na Europa é uma matéria, aquilo que vou dizer é uma matéria que também está sobre a mesa, em força, há uma preocupação que emergiu, que surgiu nesta pandemia, que é não deixar ninguém desprotegido. Isso teve mais força, isto é importante. Então, no nosso país é muito importante. Embora as proteções que até agora se avançaram para os designados desprotegidos em absoluto são ainda minimalistas e não chegam de forma alguma. Mas é um sinal, e considero um sinal positivo. Portanto, ninguém deve ficar desprotegido, ponto final. Mas reparemos na subversão que emerge de imediato. Por exemplo, as plataformas digitais, que à escala global, veja-se o relatório da Organização Internacional do Trabalho recente, o relatório mundial sobre as plataformas digitais, que pagam o trabalho à escala global a 3,21 euros à hora, e, portanto, trabalho mais qualificado e menos qualificado, mas feito nas plataformas digitais, e que usam em grande medida, não é, para essa execução, o teletrabalho, repito, a 3,21 dólares à hora, obrigando muitas vezes o indivíduo que trabalha nas plataformas e que o faz por teletrabalho a estar um dia à espera de um momento para ganhar uns tostões, porque num dia pode-lhe aparecer só uma oportunidade pontual de fazer umas micro tarefas, não é? Como sabemos. Então eu dizia, é importante que tenha surgido esta preocupação, não deixar ninguém desprotegido, mas as plataformas, a primeira coisa que há a fazer não é dizer que o orçamento do Estado substitua na proteção àqueles que as plataformas deixam desprotegidos. Não, o caminho deve ser levar as plataformas a que cumpram as suas obrigações fiscais, na segurança social, etc., junto aos países. A União Europeia está atrasadíssima disto. Este é um tópico que eu gostava muito que na presidência portuguesa, por exemplo, se pegasse e se desenvolvesse. E obrigado pela vossa paciência para me ouvirem.
Muito obrigado. Foi de facto aqui uma intervenção muito relevante e que dá continuidade ao tema que foi inicialmente tratado pelo professor Renato Miguel do Carmo. E que mostra que, no fundo, isto não é apenas uma questão de combate às desigualdades, é muito importante a discussão no contexto da União Europeia, mas é um combate que tem que ser feito também a nível nacional. E no fundo, esta questão, por exemplo, que foi aqui suscitada a propósito das plataformas, é infelizmente um problema muito comum entre nós, que é, por vezes, o primeiro passo seria fazer cumprir a lei, não é? Para podermos resolver algumas destas questões, o primeiro passo seria fazermos aplicar as leis que já temos. Com as minhas desculpas à professora Cláudia Mons, que está aqui mesmo no fim, a reta final. Professora, faça favor.
Vai-nos muito falar boa noite.
A saúde, não é?
Muito bem. Muito boa noite a todos. Agradeço antes de mais o convite e aqui na pessoa do professor Eduardo Paz Ferreira e também esta moderação do professor Miguel Mori Silva. E cumprimento todos e agradeço desde já que beneficiámos todos da excelência das apresentações. Eu procurarei ser muito breve, pede-me aqui o nosso moderador que tente observar os 10 minutos. Eu tinha preparado uma apresentação que partilho convosco, mas vou naturalmente passá-la em revista apenas nos seus aspectos mais essenciais. Alguns tópicos de enquadramento, só para situarmos aqui a matéria naquilo que a saúde em especial respeita neste combate às desigualdades, e depois, no quadro desta Europa social, olharmos para a doença como um vetor de desigualdade, como causa de discriminação, e depois para os desafios que aqui são colocados neste âmbito. Portanto, o tópico essencial é também reconhecer desde logo aqui a vinculação ao Estado, vinculação dos Estados-membros já no âmbito desta proteção internacional da saúde como um direito humano e entendendo a União Europeia como um espaço de realização desses direitos fundamentais e partindo deste patamar e do reconhecimento que a doença tem sido causa de discriminação. Isto também no quadro do artigo 3º do Tratado da União Europeia, que reconhece então este desenvolvimento dos valores de direito internacional e do respeito dos direitos humanos, passando aqui muito rapidamente em revista. Portanto, aqui decorriam ou decorrem para todos os Estados-membros também, sobre a égide deste artigo 3º, o respeito, a obrigação de respeito, de proteger e de fazer cumprir. E aqui é um aspecto muito importante, e este é o primeiro tópico, esta obrigação de cumprir a saúde como direito humano e como direito fundamental implica então que os Estados adotem as medidas apropriadas de caráter legislativo, administrativo, orçamental, aqui inelutável, e para garantia desta plena efetividade do direito à saúde. Portanto, eu procurarei aqui ser mais breve, e esta ideia que toca também os pontos que as colegas tão bem trataram, esta ideia de que também no caso da saúde não temos que olhar aqui independentemente da nação, do território, da origem, da residência ou da jurisdição, e portanto dar a proteção devida no espaço europeu. Um reconhecimento também desta indivisibilidade dos direitos humanos, portanto, e a saúde é muito clara na afirmação, ou esta afirmação é muito clara no domínio da saúde, não é? Tudo acaba e começa na saúde, e a evidência da pandemia tem-nos trazido isto mesmo e a articulação com outros direitos. Isto implica também olharmos com muita atenção para aquilo que são as determinantes em saúde, e desde as condições de trabalho, as condições económicas, sociais, a educação sanitária, a literacia, e é também por isso, às vezes é criticado o conceito, parece demasiado amplo, que consta de saúde da Constituição da Organização Mundial de Saúde, parece quase uma definição que se aproxima de felicidade, este estado de completo bem-estar, mas ao mesmo tempo ele dá este mote de que temos que cuidar da assistência, do tratamento, da prestação de cuidados de saúde, mas também a montante daquilo que são as condições que interferem nesse estado de saúde. E como dizia o professor Manuel Carvalho da Silva, aqui percebemos que a pandemia não foi muito democrática e não é muito democrática, não é? Porque a incidência do vírus também tem relevo às condições económicas, sociais, o modo em como as pessoas habitam, e depois também a mortalidade tem tido aqui incidência sobre aqueles que são mais vulneráveis. Temos que olhar também no quadro das competências que são as da União em matéria de saúde e competências partilhadas, à luz do artigo 4º e também do artigo 168 do Tratado sobre o Funcionamento da União Europeia, e esta importância da saúde pública como uma ação da União, que agora temos sentido na vigilância das ameaças graves para a saúde com dimensão transfronteiriça, e na necessidade da adoção de medidas de combate. E, portanto, também aqui. Isto, claro que coloca um problema ou uma atenção aqui, se é perante a pergunta de devem ser reforçadas as ações das instituições europeias no domínio da saúde, não podemos deixar de reconhecer que aquilo que estabelecem os tratados institutivos é sobretudo esse caráter de complementaridade com as políticas nacionais. Os sistemas de saúde nos Estados-membros são muito diferentes, mas há aqui a necessidade desse reforço, dessa cooperação e de ações que sejam concertadas. A afirmação do direito à proteção da saúde como um direito fundamental, não é? Também na Carta de Direitos Fundamentais da União Europeia, com esta dupla vertente, prevenção em matéria de saúde e depois a prestação de cuidados médicos, de acordo com as legislações e práticas nacionais, mas depois esta ideia muito fulcral e que tem que ser incrementada, e é um desafio que também seja incrementada nesta nova presidência, de definição e execução em todas as políticas e ações da União Europeia, a persecução deste elevado nível de proteção da saúde humana, não é? Portanto, a afirmação clara trazida no direito da União Europeia de health in all policies. Isso leva-nos aqui a alguns desafios em síntese, e procurando mesmo ser aqui sintética, a ideia de centralidade na pessoa, a importância das determinantes em saúde e da promoção da saúde, a saúde em todas as políticas, a clareza da essencialidade da adoção de políticas públicas plurissectoriais, e o combate à pandemia trouxe também essa evidência, desde logo perante a população mais idosa, mais vulnerável, a importância que reveste a articulação entre vários ministérios, as equipas de intervenção rápida junto dos lares, a articulação aqui, saúde, segurança social, trabalho, portanto, nesses domínios muito relevante, e a avaliação do impacto na saúde de outras políticas. Isto é, quer em termos ambientais, quer em termos urbanísticos, quer em termos da adoção de políticas económicas e políticas sociais, é preciso medir qual é o impacto que isso vai ter na saúde da população. Reconhecermos que a proteção da saúde é um vetor de igualdade, para isso também tem que ser garantida a equidade na distribuição dos recursos. Reconhecer como a evidência que é a saúde como vetor do desenvolvimento da economia, e depois ter uma prática de avaliação das políticas de saúde e a avaliação também do desempenho através de ganhos, de ganhos em saúde, que há alguma tendência para a alteração cíclica das políticas de saúde em razão da política governativa, sem que muitas vezes seja feita uma avaliação exata daquilo que é o benefício de uma ou outra política de saúde. E aquilo que já era uma realidade e que o contexto pandémico só veio reforçar, a necessidade de incremento do financiamento na área da saúde, que deixemos de considerar como despesa pública e entendamos como um investimento. Quanto aos desafios, aqui são muitos, alguns já não são novos, e portanto há esta necessidade de garantir o acesso equitativo, de assegurar a tal resiliência dos sistemas de saúde, o investimento na área da saúde e a prevenção da propagação e a garantia da assistência. Uma ideia muito clara que esta vulnerabilidade também dos mais idosos aqui trouxe, uma afirmação de igual dignidade, e ela tem que ser garantida até, inclusive nas chamadas escolhas trágicas, não é? Que o critério não pode ser, a idade, e aqui a existência de desigualdades em saúde e que a doença vai agudizar essas desigualdades. A desigualdade económica e social promove a doença e a doença vai agudizar outras desigualdades económicas e sociais, porque é muitas vezes incapacitante para a própria força produtiva e para o trabalho. A pandemia trouxe aqui muitas outras afirmações, estou a tentar observar aqui o tempo, que ela sirva também para gerar aqui alguma aprendizagem, porque os sistemas de saúde europeus foram colocados numa situação extrema, não é? E que agora se retirem daqui conclusões na prevenção, na educação para a saúde, no controle da doença e em todos os níveis de cuidados. Passando muito, muito rapidamente em revista estes novos e velhos desafios. Reconhecemos esta competência como uma competência partilhada, mas temos que fazer aqui o apelo ao princípio da cooperação leal entre os Estados e à importância de uma resposta concertada perante uma ameaça transfronteiriça. Eu acho que essa resposta não foi logo imediata naquilo que diz respeito à crise sanitária, e a Comissão veio depois a assumi-lo e depois procurou-se apelar a esses princípios e veio a resposta a ser mais eficaz. E, portanto, também aqui a importância da literacia em saúde e a compreensão de como as condições económicas podem afetar a doença. Quanto a essa especial vulnerabilidade, o tal imperativo da adoção de políticas públicas plurissectoriais, já sabemos que aqui temos uma categoria suspeita de violação do princípio da igualdade. Temos que, em especial naquilo que diz respeito ao caso português, dois indicadores que persistem em não ser muito favoráveis, não é? A necessidade, e que apontam para uma necessidade da melhoria dos anos de vida saudáveis a partir dos 65 e naquilo que diz respeito à saúde mental. A pandemia veio trazer também um reforço de uma afirmação, que é a importância da investigação em saúde e a compreensão de que ela tem que ser vista também como um bem comum, e isso tem conduzido também a esta perspectiva de investimento pelas instituições europeias na investigação em saúde. Outro aspecto muito importante e que deve ser incrementado nestas novas presidências, ou nesta presidência e na seguinte, penso que vai ser um desafio ainda mais do que um semestre, é a transparência na informação e a disponibilidade. Percebemos a importância que tem o tratamento atualizado dos dados epidemiológicos e como eles importam para essas medidas de saúde a adotar. E, portanto, aqui tinha uma análise mais desenvolvida quanto ao reforço da proteção da saúde da população mais idosa, e depois disponibilizei também a apresentação, se houver interesse na mesma. Citava aqui um estudo da Escola Nacional de Saúde Pública que apontou também esta fragilidade e a maior incidência na população idosa e aquilo que seria essa resposta. Temos publicado há dias, e que merece toda a atenção, o novo relatório da Health in a Glance, relativo a 2020, e que aponta aqui estes traços como os traços essenciais no seu sumário. Alguns deles coincidem com os seus aspectos, ou em traços gerais, nos aspectos que já vos salientei. Reforça este relatório da Health in a Glance a importância, no caso da resposta à Covid, que aqui persistirá nos próximos meses, a atenção especial para os lares, para a assistência àqueles que estão em situação de maior debilidade, e portanto novas medidas aqui têm que ser adotadas. E depois a evidência, uma das conclusões deste relatório é também de que aquilo que já é consabido, que não é possível controlar a economia sem controlar a saúde pública, e há aqui este caráter intrínseco das duas. O trio da presidência, no programa que aprovou para estes 18 meses, Alemanha, Portugal e Eslovénia, veio salientar aqui aspectos que eu também anotava neste espírito de solidariedade e que a crise da Covid-19 reforçou, em traços muito gerais, num minuto, a ideia de necessidade de reforçar o multilateralismo e um reforço dessa cooperação e multilateralismo, desde logo entre a União Europeia e a Organização Mundial de Saúde, a colaboração com o setor da investigação e a inovação no desenvolvimento da vacina, depois uma chamada de atenção para a acessibilidade nos cuidados de saúde e para a capacidade dos sistemas de saúde, portanto construir infraestruturas mais resilientes, também a evidência do acesso não só médico como medicamentoso, e aqui a garantia da prestação de cuidados de saúde de elevada qualidade, e que implica também essa qualidade no acesso aos medicamentos, que preocupação que agora também está na ordem do dia, e depois o reconhecimento da importância das tais determinantes em saúde, quer na ligação entre saúde e biodiversidade, saúde e ambiente, quer na articulação entre saúde e emprego e outros assuntos e outras preocupações sociais, esta correlação que casa também com a matéria de refugiados, de ajuda humanitária, de problemas que são prementes, mas esta correlação entre a ajuda humanitária, a própria saúde como um vetor do desenvolvimento da paz, e aquilo que é a importância aqui de outros vetores. E ainda nas determinantes em saúde, reconhece também o programa do trio da presidência a necessidade de melhoria do investimento na competência das pessoas, no desenvolvimento da tal educação das pessoas para a saúde e para medidas de prevenção e que possam para um bem comum contribuir, e naquilo que é também o potencial da investigação e da inovação. Essa centralidade é também destacada agora na recente comunicação da Comissão ao Parlamento sobre a égide de uma economia ao serviço das pessoas, e esta ideia do pilar europeu dos direitos sociais como a bússola também da recuperação da Europa. Este esforço de cooperação, e terminava dizendo, salientando que temos que reconhecer esta proteção da saúde pública exatamente como res pública que importa proteger, entender essa proteção da saúde também como um fator de coesão europeu, e no fundo parece-me que precisamos de uma União Europeia da saúde mais forte. A expressão não é minha, é da Comissão, e com ela terminava. Muito bem, muito obrigada pela atenção e peço desculpa aqui pelo ritmo acelerado. Obrigada a todos.
Irmãos, fico com consciência pesada de ter...
Não, eu também peço desculpa, tenho uma aula agora às 8 e, portanto, foi um gosto e obrigada a todos e continuação de uma boa noite.
Bom, gostaria de agradecer ao professor Eduardo Paz Ferreira o convite para moderar esta sessão. Este tema é um tema inesgotável e tenho certeza que o professor Paz Ferreira nos vai desafiar durante a presidência, após a presidência, para voltarmos a estes temas. E por isso agradeço a todos os oradores, foram intervenções excelentes, aprendi imenso convosco e agradeço-vos muito e agradeço também a todos a paciência de estarem connosco até ao final desta sessão. Muito obrigado e de hoje a 8 dias lá teremos mais uma das nossas conferências. Muito obrigado então e uma boa noite a todos.